6. We teased this song last week, but now we get to play it in full. This is Hellfekted Method of Destruction.
The future! Only the destruction!
No lies.
Hellfekted and their new single Method of Destruction. Next up is our interview for the week. Okay, today in the virtual studio, we welcome James McBain, or as most people will know him, Hellripper. Welcome to the studio, mate. How you doing?
Not too bad. Thank you very much for having me on.
No worries. Really appreciate thanks for joining us. So, kind of Hellripper seems to be at the helm of bringing back kind of UK black and speed metal, black and thrash, whatever you want to call it, a bit of revival. Did you imagine that when you kind of started out that the genre was going to kind of gather so much steam behind it again and be kind of putting out lots of new bands with a kind of under a similar vein?
Yeah, I mean, at the time, I didn't have thoughts about anything going further really than a couple of people listening to the EP. The first EP that I put out, like in my local scene, and maybe they would enjoy it and stuff. But I think my timing was quite good as well. Like just when I put out the first EP, I think the black thrash, metal punk, black speed, like all that type of stuff was gaining popularity. And like, so yeah, around these past few years, it's seen a big spike in popularity, especially like with bands like Midnight and stuff. But no, like when I started, I had no vision other than, yeah, like my local scene liking it. I didn't realize how far it would go. It was just a thing I recorded for fun, like at home. And yeah, so.
So you spoke then about your local scene. You're kind of Aberdeen way, aren't you? You're kind of...
And not anymore. Okay. I was in Aberdeen up until 2018, I think. Then I moved down to Fife for a year last year, and now I'm up in the Highlands. So I've moved further away than I was before.
So you're even further into the sticks.
Oh yeah, like right where I am right now, there's nothing. there's nothing like in terms of metal music or gigs and stuff like that happening. I think the closest place to me is Inverness, but even then there's a local scene up there, but bands don't really go there. It's too out of the way. And I'm about three hours from Glasgow or something like that. Be like the closest.
Yeah.
That'd be the closest like big city to me. But yeah.
So is that part of the reason why it's kind of remained a solo project? Is that, you know, you're so far away from a gang of musicians that you can tap into?
Yeah, it was at the start. I mean, when I started, that was when I was in Aberdeen, and there is more of a scene in Aberdeen, and there's definitely people there. But when I started, I was just kind of getting involved with the scene in Aberdeen. So I didn't really know many people, let alone that played instruments and things. I was just kind of starting another band with my friend, and that was kind of making our way into the scene and stuff. And I wanted to record like black thrash, kind of like the Hellripper stuff, and didn't think I would be able to get a band together because I didn't know anyone at the time. And over the years, like obviously I became more aware of people, and I met people that were willing to play with me live and stuff. So the original reason was because I didn't know people, but over the years I enjoy the process. I like working alone a lot better. I find it easier. I don't need to deal with anyone's schedules. I don't need to book studio time. I don't need to get people to agree with me for what I want to do. Yeah, there's like no compromises or anything. So just over the years, that's became the reason that it's stayed like this.
So you touched on live then. How do you go about kind of filling those boots? Because obviously you can't play every instrument and do every job on stage. Is that session musicians? Is that kind of roping in mates? Is it, how's that working at the moment?
Yeah, it's just mates. Right now, I've got my friend Clarky, I've been friends with him for about 5 years or something, 6 years, I can't remember. he was one of the first guys I met when I came into the Aberdeen scene. He's playing bass. I've got my friend Joseph, who he played in a couple of indie bands in Aberdeen, and I needed a guitarist, and I saw him online. I was familiar with his band, and I knew he liked Metallica and Motorhead and stuff like that, so I just gave him a message. If you can play Metallica and Motorhead, if you're a fan of that, then you should fit in Hellripper, sorry. And yeah, Max, our current drummer, he lives down in Brighton. So he is a guy that I found through Twitter. I put out a thing when I needed a drummer. I just put out a little tweet, and yeah, there was a quick reply. I thought it was going to be really difficult to find a drummer, because usually it is.
Yeah, drummers are always seem to be the one that people are searching for, you know, that
exactly.
They're in about 10 bands already.
Exactly. So yeah, I was not really expecting any results, but yeah, I think, I can't remember, it was a day or two, I got a message from him. I think he was referred to me by his friend, who's a fan of the band. And yeah, he agreed to, he sent a video, like a cover video of a couple of our songs within like a day or two or something like that. And he was great. And yeah, he was a great fit. And like, yeah, they're all cool guys. So it's like really easy to get along with them, and which is the main thing I look for. And they're all amazing musicians as well. So
yeah. So do you, when you write and record, do you have at the back of your mind, I've got to show someone else how to do this, or I've got to, you know, do you tab everything, or did you write all his music so the guys can learn it as well, or how does that all work?
Because
obviously,
yeah,
you're playing your style and you're trying to get someone else to replicate the record live.
Yeah, well, I tab everything. That's how I write everything. I write it on a Tux guitar, which is like a MIDI kind of tab software, like similar to Guitar Pro. So basically, it's a useful writing tool for me, first of all. So I was using that before I had any ambitions of playing live. So I can write down the tabs for all the instruments and everything. And basically, by the time I record, I have a finished song, like with all the drums, the bass, the guitars. I have a finished song in MIDI format with all the tabs for each instrument laid out. So that makes it really easy for other people to learn. I just send it to them and they can learn it. But yeah, I don't really try and make them replicate exactly like the style on the album as well. I give them, like, as long as their stuff like fits with the sound.
Yeah, so they can put some extra fills in, or yeah, you know, go off the note a little bit, but as long as it fits the overall.
Yeah, exactly. Track. It's, yeah, I don't want to like limit them to like do exactly what I do. Like I'm like that in the studio, but live, like, yeah, it's cool to give other people their freedom to do what they do. And
so yeah,
if something isn't working, if something isn't working, we'll say, but
yeah. So you're only 50% a megalomaniac. It's all right in the studio live, but he's got
exactly.
It.
Yeah.
So before you go on the road, what, you know, is that a kind of everyone gets together and try and bang out a few kind of rehearsal sessions to all get, you know, because obviously all being separated, and do you jam together online and stuff, or do you just kind of try and rent some rehearsal space and go for it before you go out and play live gigs?
Yeah, usually we just get a rehearsal space. We meet like sort of in the middle, like we meet in I think it's Edinburgh. Yeah, we meet in Edinburgh usually 2-3 times for a few hours, like before we have like a show or tour planned, and we all just meet there, and everyone learns their songs beforehand, so it's just kind of like tightening up things, and because yeah, all the other guys are like good at what they do, it's not really a problem. Like, it's not, no one turns up and we can't play the songs and it's a disaster.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's good that everyone knows what they're doing. We turn up and we just kind of make sure we get tighter and stuff like that. So it's not too difficult.
It's not too onerous. So what about the new stuff?
Yeah.
Have the guys learnt all the new stuff, or they've been learning that during lockdown, ready to hopefully get the release to start doing some shows early next year?
Yeah, we planned on adding, I think it was 3 or 4 songs to the set. And they learned them ages ago because I finished the album in December last year. So, and I sent them like while I was recording and stuff. So they like practiced, I think 3 or 4 songs that I planned to add to the set list for shows. And obviously they never happened, but yeah, it's given us time to do all that. And hopefully we're ready for shows if they happen next year, or when they'll happen next year. I've got no idea.
So why the big gap between finishing and releasing the album in October? Was that, you know, was that slipped because of COVID, or was that kind of?
So yeah, it was planned to be released in, I think it was either April or May. Yeah, I think it was May. And just as kind of things, just as we were kind of doing the promotion and getting the PR and stuff, the COVID kind of like happened and started getting a bit crazy. So both Peaceville and I decided, like, we had no idea what was going to happen within the next month or two. Like, would like everything just be like shut down? Because I think at the time, like, record shops and stuff were closing. Yeah, loads of shit was happening at that time. So we were like, yeah, we'll delay it till later in the year. Maybe things will be a lot better. And I mean, they are better, but
yeah, not quite perfect.
not too much. But yeah, we thought we might as well like see, give the album a chance, like delay it until the end of the year. And we had a tour planned at the same time as well, like just with Midnight in Europe, which obviously was cancelled. But that was, we thought if we put it next to the tour as well, it might help. But then, yeah, that got cancelled, so it didn't matter anyway. But yeah, it's just given me time to write new stuff. So yeah,
I was going to say, are you already another album in by the time we finish lockdown?
Yeah, I hope to have everything recorded by summer. Yeah, I've written about 3 or 4 songs, like completely, and I'm in various stages on the other ones. But yeah, it's just given me time to do all that kind of stuff, and without the live shows and all that, it's, yeah, everyone I think has just got more time to do stuff at home. So
yeah. So what about, you know, when you said when you started in Aberdeen that, you know, you were only just getting into the scene and stuff like that, how did it kind of go about that, you know, suddenly you had material to release, and did you have quite a steep learning curve, especially obviously you know musicianship wise that wasn't such a big deal, but what about the business side of it and learning to, you know, utilize social and Spotify and all that other guff to, you know, was that quite a steep learning curve for you?
And it kind of, I guess it just kind of happened naturally and like gradually, because I think, like, I guess the good thing is it, like, the band never like exploded. So like I didn't go from nothing to like headlining Vakken style stuff, you know what I mean? So like it wasn't like an extreme learning curve in a very short time. So it was like over the years I've gradually learned how to use social media like better. I studied like business at uni as well, so that kind of helped in that respect. But yeah, it's just kind of learning as I go, like with the mixing and recording. That was half the reason I wanted to do Hellripper as well, because I wanted to learn how to mix and record stuff on my own. So I had no experience at all before Hellripper, and then over the years I think I've improved in that respect. And yeah, it's just the same with everything else. You just kind of learn as you go, be it through trial and error or by making mistakes, or if other people's share their experience. I mean, there's been a lot of people that have helped me like with the band and helped the band grow. So I'm very grateful for that as well.
What about on the merch side? You know, I think your merch has become kind of fairly instantly recognisable, and, you know, you bump into people and they see the patch on your denim and you get the orb thrown up at you and, you know, all that sort of stuff. You know, it seems to have happened fairly organically from, you know, you sat there in your merch store now, but, it, you know, yeah. it, is that kind of has that helped? And it sounds a bit shit, but you know, has that helped create you as a brand, as something that people want to, you know, that makes you recognizable?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, the merch just happened, or like, yeah, organically, like you say. And yeah, I mean, it's just, it's cool to have the, like, the brand. I like to have cool merch. Like, I try and make, I don't want to release stuff that I'm not happy with, like, just for the sake of releasing it and stuff. Like, if people want something, then I've got no problem. Like, if there's a demand for it, then I've got no problem in, like, in printing it or whatever. But I don't want to do, like, stupid stuff just for the sake of it, or, like, and that kind of stuff. But I'm happy with, like, all the merch designs and stuff I've got. I've worked with great artists that have obviously helped make the merch look that good. Yeah, there is a lot of it, but people want loads of different things, and I'm very happy to do that.
So obviously, kind of up until kind of the Peaceville deal, you did everything yourself. But how much has that changed? How much do Peaceville, you know, showing interest, because they, you know, they've got a vested interest, yeah, in making sure it's good. But you know, have they stepped in and said, oh, you don't need to do that yourself anymore, or have you kept the reins of most of the stuff?
Yeah, I kept the reins of most of the stuff because I like doing it. Peaceville help a lot, of course, with like the promotion, and they've got like with their PR, and they do the, and they press everything, obviously, and so that's stuff that I'm glad I don't have to do, like dealing with the pressing and all that kind of stuff. And so I'm free to just do basically, yeah, the process is basically the exact same as what it was before, just with like extra help in promotion and extra help in some other areas. So it's, yeah.
Yeah.
As if once you get signed, it's not like the end. Like you haven't like made it, and you don't like relax. Like you still have to put in the work, and you have to work with the label. Like you have to work with other people. You have to do the work as well. Yeah. Otherwise it's just half the work getting done. And
I guess that's probably changed. You know, you look back at kind of the late 80s bands, or who once they got signed, you know, they seem to, you know, just concentrate on making music and don't worry too much about the rest of it. But you know, I think, you know, modern bands still need to put that work in themselves. It's not, you know, it's not like someone's going to step in and do all your social media and, you know, everything else for you.
Yeah, I mean, you can hire someone to do social media for you. You can hire merch companies. You can hire all that. But I mean, yeah.
Yeah, you need a lot of Spotify streams to pay for all that, though, don't you?
Oh, yeah. At least 10.
Yeah. So how did the Peaceville thing come about? You know, did they court you, or were you out there kind of saying, I've got something to offer and looking for labels, or was it the other way around?
Yeah, they emailed me while we were on tour, just a couple of days after I released the last EP, the Black Arts EP. And we were on our way to London to play with Midnight at the Dome, and we were stuck in traffic. I checked my emails, and I had an email from Peaceville, like saying, "Oh, what are you doing? Are you interested in doing something with us, like for the next album?" So, and that was basically it. I think they were turned. Paul, the label manager, was turned on to the band by a friend who was a fan of the band, and yeah, he just got in contact with me, and it was fairly smooth from there. It was just like emails back and forth for a while.
So yeah. Obviously, you know, I mean, Peaceville have been around for a long, long time, and you know, they've got some, especially in the back catalogue, they've got some real heritage through UK, doom metal, and when, you know, they were very big at the start of that scene, that they had some of the big names. You know, do you think Peaceville's a good fit for you as a band, as an individual?
Yeah, I think so. They've got Dark Throne, who's one of my biggest influences, like the punk era of Dark Throne, so like that, and they've had bands like Or Noir and stuff like that in the past, and yeah, they've got some of my favorite bands like Bloodbath, Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, they've definitely got like the good bands. They know what they're doing, and yeah, it's just they're easy to work with, which is the main thing for me. Like,
yeah,
I don't like send emails and get ignored or just say, oh no, you can't do that and stuff like that. It's been every suggestion or idea that I've had, like it's been considered and it's been like put through if I really want to do it. And
yeah,
everything's like, yeah, it's just easy to work with them and stuff like that. So that's the main thing for me.
And I guess the other way as well, they're not too, you know, they're not trying to make you take your creative control away. They're, you know, they're quite happy to let you do you, and they'll promote you to the best of their ability.
Yeah, exactly. Not at all. Like I finished the album and sent it to them, and that was it. I think I sent one demo in progress to the label and like just one song, and they said, yeah, that's sounding cool.
Yeah, crack on.
And then I finished the album. Yeah, I finished the album, sent it to them, and they said, yeah, it's sounding good. We'll get started like with all this kind of stuff.
So, is that just a one album thing, or are you gonna, you know, is the next one going to be with them as well, or is that still to be discussed?
I think it's still to be discussed, but I think the next one will be through Peaceville. But yeah, we haven't really discussed it yet because we've just released the last album, so it was
and I'm not extreme
far, like nearly finished. So yeah, it'll probably come up in the next couple of months, like whatever's happening. But I imagine the next one will be through them, unless something happens. I've got no idea.
So, Affairs of the Poison came out, as we said, kind of October in the end. What's the reception been like overall? Have you had lots of positive feedback?
Yeah, most of it's been good from what I've seen. People seem to like it. Yeah, I mean, I can't complain. I'm happy with how it turned out, which is the main thing to me. And I'm really glad that people have liked it. Yeah, I mean, the reviews seem to have been good.
How much do you follow that stuff? Or do you just kind of, as you say, you do it for you and you do it because it's the project you want to make. So you kind of, you know, opinions are great, but they're not the end of the world.
Yeah, I do it. Yeah, for me, like primarily, but I always like to see what people are saying, if they enjoy it, if they don't enjoy it and stuff. But, I'm on social media, like speaking to the, like I've got a Hellripper like group page where people like discuss anything like Hellripper related or black thrash related, metal related and all that kind of stuff. Like just kind of like a community place, if you know what I mean, for people that like the band. And I'm always on there and getting their opinions, asking for their ideas and stuff. Like if there's anything they want to see in terms of like, yeah, merch or like an edition of the album or yeah, like what color t-shirts they want, what color tapes and stuff like, so. And they're always like giving their opinions and yeah, so I'm always like paying attention to all that. But the main thing is that I'm happy. If the response to this album was completely horrible, it wouldn't be the best, but I'd be okay because I'm happy with how it turned out. So that's the main thing. But I do like pay attention.
So you were, you know, obviously people at this time of year are all busy scribbling down their top lists and, you know, countdowns from 10 and whatever. You are you expecting or you're hoping to see yourself in a couple of places?
I hope so. I mean, there's been loads of cool albums this year. So, yeah, if people think of the album that highly, then it's crazy. Like, it's really cool for me to see. But, yeah. Like I said, there's been so much cool albums this year, so...
Well, yeah. I'll put you on the spot with that yourself then. So what's kind of your top three? What would be your top three for the year now?
Top three would be Midnight, Rebirth by Blasphemy, Warbringer, Weapons of Tomorrow, and Butcher, 666 Goats, Carry My Chariot.
That's the Warbringer one in the middle of there is quite a little bit slightly off-piste. It's a bit, you know, a bit more modern thrash than I'd expect.
Yeah, I love Warbringer. I think they're probably my favourite modern thrash band, if you want to call them that. But yeah, their last two albums have been great.
Yeah, that new one this year, I think, is, you know, was the last one was good, but this Future Tomorrow is massive. just seems to be a massive step up. I was really impressed with that one.
Yeah, they're so good.
Say, obviously, as we touched on earlier, this year has been a complete shit bus for live shows and all that sort of stuff. But what's plans? What is on the agenda for next year? Have you kind of rescheduled the tour, or are you just still sat in a bit of limbo, waiting to see if the vaccine cures us all or makes us grow an extra head?
Mainly waiting. We've rescheduled like the festival appearances that we were doing. So we've got one in Edinburgh, Pitfest in the Netherlands, and Metal Days festival. I think they're in the first half of the year to summer. We've rescheduled them because we were due to play them last year. But other than that, like, we haven't really looked, but we haven't really been actively trying to get stuff, because I don't really want to announce a tour and then have to cancel it. So we've been speaking for a couple of things. We've got one thing in the UK that we confirmed for late next year, that's to be announced at some point. But mainly we're working on a couple of things for early 2022. So that'll probably coincide with the next album as well, I imagine, whenever that's released. I imagine the next album will be released between October and April or something.
Sure.
If everything goes well, if I don't delete the whole album before before I finish it.
Fuck off.
Yeah.
That sounds ominous. Have you done that before? No, I don't like it. Fucking bin it.
Oh, yeah, all the time. Absolutely all the time. Not the whole albums, just usually a song, like songs. I quite like rash decision. I'll be like, instead of like keeping the song and repurposing it, like getting riffs from it, I'm just like, no, the whole thing's shit. And then I get rid of it, and then I'm like, oh, there was a cool riff actually in that song. I need to try and work it out again, or I need to look through my recycle bin and find it.
Brilliant. Yeah, hope that you printed the tab out somewhere so you could, oh shit, I can teach it myself again.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Look through all the notes on my phone, like, oh, did I record a little demo thing? Like, then I've got to try and work it out by ear, then I'm...
Just throw it on a hard drive somewhere. Just get a USB stick. I don't want it, but I'm not going to bin it. What about kind of other projects? You know, you seem to be... I know earlier on you definitely seem to be involved in loads of projects at the same time. Is that still the case? Have you got any other kind of irons in the fire?
Yeah. I've got I think the next thing that I will release is I'm working on an EP, like a crust punk crossover EP type thing. I've got one song done for that and a couple of others like in various stages of completion. So I think my aim is to release that in the next couple of months.
Is that solo project?
It'll be me and my girlfriend will be doing it. I've got like 50 other things, like 50 other like projects just that happen when they happen. Like, I don't really, like, if an idea comes, I pursue it, but I'm not like, it's not urgent, if you know what I mean. So... yeah, like, and most of my time this past while has been taken up by Hellripper and doing various things for Hellripper, and that's where my inspirations like came from as well. So yeah, I've been focusing on that, but yeah, there's other projects that'll see the light of day at some point, I imagine.
Maybe.
Yeah, at some point between next year and
infinity. Yeah. So what's the crust punk project? Is that kind of, you know, crass type crust punk, or what sort of?
Well, at the moment, like the original plan was kind of like your Swedish type stuff, but it'll just come from anywhere. I think it's going to be like just general fast kind of thrashy punk D beat kind of stuff. Probably will lie somewhere between like Wolf Brigade and Discharge and Carnivore or something, like just kind of like thrashy deep. Yeah, just whatever comes. I mean, yeah, I've got no idea
what the end product's going to turn out like. So,
yeah.
Do you have to click on it, watch yourself, and say, "Oh shit, that sounds too Hellripper. I need you know, that's in the wrong folder on my desktop. I need to think about moving that across."
Sometimes it happens. Sometimes I write like a death metal song or something, and then I think this riff would work really well like in Hellripper, so I do that. But it depends on the context as well. I mean, I've got like a writing style, so everything is going to kind of sound somewhat familiar, so like somewhat similar style. So it's just about the context, really. Like, different riffs work well in different parts. So I've kind of just got like a bank of riffs, and then when I'm writing a song for say death metal, like my project Lord Rot or Hellripper or whatever, I might like check to see if another riff will fit in there, and if it does, then fair enough. But it hasn't really been a big problem so far.
And apart from the girlfriend, are these all solo projects, or have you got, are you doing, yeah. Okay, so and is, yeah, that solo. Again, just because you like doing it yourself and having your own timeline, yeah, not getting involved in all the drama, yeah, of being in a band?
Yeah, exactly. Just saves time, saves money on studios and travel, and yeah, I mean, I say it saves time. I mean, because it's only me, I'm the only one contributing. So obviously the ideas sometimes take a lot of time to get there. If there was like four people contributing, maybe things would get done in a timely manner. But yeah, just the process is more fun for me. I was working, or I still am working on a project with a couple of people, like online, like internationally. But that's been, everyone's like got their own thing going on. I've got Hellripper. One of the guys owns a label, so he's doing, and his label's like doing really well, so he's doing that. And the other guy is in another band that's taking off, like doing really well as well. So everyone's kind of, no one's schedules align, which is, yeah.
Just the way of the world. But what you talked about doing things internationally there. Every time I look at your kind of social media stories and all that stuff, you know, you get fans from all over the world saying, you know, come and play Rio, come, yeah, and play Norway, come and play, you know, Timbuktu, you know,
yeah.
Is that, obviously finances permitting, is that something you like to do? Do you want to take the band, you know, not just into Europe but all over the world?
Yeah definitely. I don't want to tour like constantly. Like, I'm not about that. I'd rather just tour every so often, or a couple months out of the year and stuff. Like, but yeah, finances and all that, yeah, permit. I mean, it's, I think some people don't realize it's really expensive. Like, with all the, especially like to get to some countries like the USA, you've got to get your visas and all that kind of stuff. And as well as being costly, it's really time consuming. You've got to do a whole bunch of paperwork. You've got to make sure it's done right.
Yeah.
You've got to see what gear you can take, what merch you can take, or if you need to get stuff over there, and then you need to book the tour. it's not as easy as just, I'm coming to your country.
That sounds like a shit job. That's something the label could do.
Well, we've got a booking agent, so I mean, but yeah, I'm hoping to get Europe will probably happen 2022, and I'm hoping the US as well in 2022. And then, I mean, yeah, like I said, we haven't got anything set in stone yet. So whatever comes along, I'm willing to consider it. Like,
Does a festival kind of slot, you know, you can just pop over for a few days and do a festival? Is that the sort of thing that kind of floats your boat a little bit, really? If you, yeah, you know, like you mentioned Metal Days there, which is a pretty infamous one. Yeah. You know, something like that anywhere in the world, I guess, would be a great experience.
Yeah, I mean, this will be our first summer festival, I think. So, I mean, I was at Brutal Assault last year, and it was really cool. And yeah, it's just like but the atmosphere is fun, and it's just a cool thing to do. But yeah, Metal Days will be our first festival, our summer festival. And yeah, but that's cool. We can kind of go to that. And if there's no other dates around it, which I don't imagine there will be this year, then we can just kind of
go to the festival like
as punters.
Yeah, exactly. And there's cool bands, you can watch cool bands all weekend. So yeah, definitely appealing.
Excellent. Okay, finally, pimp yourself out to the world. Go social media links, merch links, anything else you want to get out there.
Cool. Yeah, check Hellripper out on Facebook. It's Hellripper1 is the URL, facebook.com/Hellripper1. Hellripper.bandcamp.com. And then that's for merch. You can download and get all the music there. What else? Instagram is Hellripper Metal. Twitter, Hellripper Metal. Yeah, and the official website is hellripper.com, where you can kind of see all of that kind of thing in one place. But yeah.
Brilliant. James, thanks for taking time out to speak to us. Cool. Hopefully we can see you on stage at some point in 2021.
I hope so. Hopefully.
Brilliant. Thanks, mate.
Thank you.
Okay, that was Hellripper. Thanks to James for joining us in the studio. This is Hellripper. This is Total Mayhem, taken from the Complete and Total Fucking Mayhem album. Keeping it black, this is Sidewinder and Ashes of Reality. Okay, next up from deepest, darkest Surrey, this is The Whip by Dead Before Mourning.
With you, cast out those who don't. trying to explain. But you won't understand. It's our way of life. This chaos wasn't planned. But you feel what you see. So scared of the unknown. Well, in this metal we're forged. All as one. Salute!
And that's the end of episode 26. Thanks to Hellripper for joining us in the studio. Thanks as always to all the bands for letting us use their music. See you next time.